fugal diversions and dilutions of the society that has made the people, in spite of knowing there is no such person available in the mature and civilized society whom we have to teach about the principles of ethics. Everybody knows everything. What we have to do is, we have to create a compulsion within the internal atmosphere that the person practices that thing. That must be created by means of a divine intimacy, a soul intimacy, which makes a person to get a spiritual determination or a moral courage by which the person is ready to face anything for implanting these qualities and emphasizing the same. So only we have to do with the methodology, and methodology is a problem of society, not ideology. We have innumerable books, workshops, lectures, publications, a lot of people to narrate stories. So innumerable resources we have in ideology. So intuitive guidance, it is a very essential thing. Once we have to organize 1 or 2 days workshop, practical workshop on intuitive guidance, how to develop an inner tuition as an assisting factor. It is not a replacement for all of your practical experience. Apart from your practical experience, apart from your knowledgeability in the particular area where you are working and learning, it is a guiding factor, it is a steering factor which takes you to the proper direction and proper destination. So how to develop this intuitive guidance? And finally, there is the rule of subjective communication. Lot of people are there, even the person may be our own son, located within the four walls. We can even advise the president of Iraq or Pakistan, we cannot advise these people. So these how to emphasize the properties of truth, honesty, obedience and other things. You must have done penance, or at least we should have done penance now, and the products of penance will be always precise, and the products of our previous activities, the collection which we call prarabdha, if it is a product of our previous collections, that prarabdha product will be like our prarabdha only, not as per our expectation or not as per our demand for our family development or social development. So then we cannot have direct guidance, then we cannot have direct control, then we cannot implant any rule of obedience by means of our direct speech, direct discussions, debate, dialectical skills and various other things. When all of our physical and oral measures fail, then we have to take the subjective communication which we have to contemplate in our inner mind, which has been proved by great psychiatrists, that a person who is emotionally attached with some person, if he communicates when the person is deep asleep, when he communicates with the person's form in his mental screen projection, or he just she or he just sees the photo or any other symbol, emblem, possession or anything of that person, if he subtly communicates, there are possibilities for gradual or drastic change in their mind structures, in rebuilding relations, creating obedience, in formulation of love and harmony. That is known as the rule of subjective communication or rule of distant communication. So these things are some issues of the life management. Number one, the rule of binding, the karmic theory. Second thing, the rule of qualification. How to qualify one's own self instead of just desiring for something else, how to qualify one's own nature and sturdity to get the benefit. Third thing is how to subtly refine one's own status by samskaras. Then there is the rule of second focus, then the rule of intuitive guidance, then finally the rule of subjective communication by which we can connect ourselves with hostile element, distant element, unknown element. Even we can contemplate for world peace. They are distant people, people suffering in Afghanistan or in Iraq or in Ethiopia, Somalia, they are distant people and deserving people, downtrodden people. And we are Jammu Kashmir, we can pray for them, that is distant communication. Then hostile communication, even people for whom we do the good, they may misunderstand and there may be a cleavage between both of us. So for those people also, for distant people, hostile people and people of different mentalities, we can bring them together, we can build a bridge of communication by means of this subjective communication methodology. Then first we have to take in various dimensions of life, the first thing is birth and progeny. That is, we are giving birth to our own children, that is progeny. We have born to our parents and that is our birth, that is Janma and Jayama. There are two issues in that. And second thing is education. Third thing is career development. Fourth thing is relation maintenance. Fifth thing is professional status. And there are three issues of securities. So as a concluding matter, I want to just precisely as well as concisely mention about these issues and conclude this session. And you know that there are two types of thoughts in the society. We think that being born to our parents and giving birth to our own issues, they are not in our hands. But the Shastra says that if a person, yoga bhrashto abhijayate, so says the Gita, a person who is practicing mystic practices, divine practices, charitable activities, activities of cosmopolitanism and altruism, he is born in good family. Srimatam, Suchinam Yehe. So he is born in a traditional family, in a resourceful family, in a serene, unpolluted, unalloyed atmosphere the person is born. So a person's deeds and activities of this time, even the parent, both parents, the parents to whom he is born and being the parents of his own issues. So one can test us now, there is a recent science, emerging science known as eugenics. Eugenics deals with genetic tailoring. Just as you are giving order to your shirt and pant, you can give order to your children. Yes, I want a child who can speak three languages, 6'2" tall, can British complexion, a person skillful in mathematics and logic, hating everybody and loving me. So we can give an order. It is known as genetic tailoring. Likewise in prarthana, by the sanskaras of Simantana or Simantonnayana, or Pumsavana, we used to call that. So even in Simanta Samskara, or even in the Garbhavana Samskara, even in Vivaha, even in the matrimonial rites, we have Prarthana, we have a lot of methodologies for creating productive child. And I told in seminar, fertility is not only producing children, issues. If it is that is the fertility, then pigs are producing piglets and puppies are produced by dogs and cats produce kittens. So, fertile fertility is producing productive children to the family, to the tradition, to the society, to the nation as a whole. And if you want such type of issues, certainly it is possible only by a spiritual process. So, if a person is having behavioral perfection, then the person has two options or two benefits. One, he can select, qualitatively select the type of family in which he wants to be born, number one. Number two, he can also select the nature or the goodness of his progeny. And if you don't do anything at all, if all the other essentials are totally abdicated, relinquished, and all the unwanted, prohibited things are very meticulously observed, then our progeny will resemble only our fate. So, this is the first thing. In our life management, we can even govern our life, consecutive lifestyles, and also we can govern our progeny.